Hi, I'm Pia. I'm an economic researcher and I teach macroeconomics. In this video, we're going to learn about open economies, more specifically the markets of loanable funds and foreign currency exchange. This will help you to understand the next concepts: the international flow of goods and assets, the market for foreign currency exchange, the market for loanable funds, which allows us to analyze the equilibrium in the open economy. Let's begin. When we speak about an open economy, it means that a country has free interaction with the other economies in the world. In order to understand this interaction, we must address the international flow of goods and assets. The international flow of goods and assets is represented in two accounts. The first one is the trade balance, or the net exports, which reflects the exchange of goods and services between an economy and the foreign sector, as well as the market for foreign currency exchange. Then we have the net capital outflow, or the net foreign investment, which is related to the flow of assets and loanable funds. The trade imbalance and the net capital outflow must be equal. This is an accounting identity. Every transaction made in the trading side must have the same outcome on the asset side, and in the same amount. This is because international trade involves exchanges and fluctuations in foreign currency. So, for example, if country A starts to export more, leading to surplus in net exports, this means that country A will have capital inflow on the other side, because the foreign sector pays for those exports with foreign currency. In other words, country A sells goods and services as exports to the foreign sector. In return, the foreign sector will provide currency to pay for the exports. That incoming currency is what we call capital inflow. So country A's exports translate to added capital or reserves. As you may see in the identity equation, the trade surplus equals the capital inflow. So let's start with the market for foreign currency exchange. First of all, we need to define the concept of trade balance and net exports. When we purchase goods and services from another country, we are importing. And when other countries buy goods and services from the economy that we are studying, this economy is exporting. Note that these concepts depend from which point we stand upon. In other words, the economy's imports are foreign countries' exports, and the other way around. In order to calculate the foreign sector's participation, we have to make the difference between what this economy receives and what this economy spends abroad. This means exports, or X, minus imports, or M, or as we say, net exports. Trade balance can experience surplus or deficit. A surplus stands for a positive result in the net exports account, which would mean that exports are higher than imports. If imports were higher than exports, this account would be negative. In other words, we would be talking about a trade balance deficit. Total income in an open economy will then be calculated by adding up consumption, investment, public spending, and the trade balance, C plus I plus G plus NX. As we previously said, every transaction in the trade balance involves an exchange in foreign currency. Exports generate higher supply for foreign currency, and imports generate higher demand of foreign currency to pay to the foreign sector. The supply and demand for foreign currency in this market are determined by the real exchange rate, represented as E star. Constructing the market for foreign currency exchange, we can observe that the real exchange rate is the price that balances the supply and demand in the market for foreign currency exchange. In an open economy, the supply for foreign currency is considered as given, so it's a vertical line. However, the demand for foreign currency is negatively related to the real exchange rate, because a rise in the real exchange rate means that exports are relatively more expensive and less attractive to foreign and domestic buyers, causing NX to fall. In other words, the more expensive the foreign currency gets, the less the quantity demanded. The equilibrium reflects, as we said before, that the demand for dollars to buy net exports must equal the supply of dollars to be exchanged into foreign currency to buy assets overseas. For example, suppose this economy experiences a trade balance surplus because of an increase in exports. As a result, people will demand less foreign currency, which makes the real exchange rate to decrease. The graph shows us how the trade balance curve, aka the demand for foreign currency, shifts in a downward direction as the orange curve, causing real exchange rate to be lower. Now let's turn to the market for loanable funds. An open economy also involves the flow of capital between countries. This is illustrated in the net capital outflow indicator, which is also referred to as the net foreign investment. The net capital outflow reflects domestic residents' purchases of foreign assets deducted by foreigners' purchases of domestic assets. These assets include what's called productive investment, for example, when local firm invests overseas, and financial investment, for example, when residents purchase foreign stocks or bonds. This account can also be positive or negative. If the NCO is positive, it means that domestic purchases of foreign assets are greater than the foreign purchases of domestic assets. This is called capital outflow, which means that a country is investing more overseas than what it's receiving from abroad. If it's negative, then this country is receiving more foreign capital, and this is called capital inflow. In order to see how the market for loanable funds operates, we have to go back to the GDP equation. We also have to add two accounting identities. First of all, in a closed economy, local savings generate local investment. This means that savings are equal to total income, minus consumption and public spending. Second, net exports are equal to net capital outflow or net foreign investment, as we said in the beginning. Rearranging the variables, we arrive to the fact that income minus consumption and public spending, which is equal to savings, equals investment plus net exports. Since net exports are the same as NCO, we are able to say that savings equal investment plus net capital outflow. This means that the net capital outflow stands for the net foreign purchases or the net outflow of loanable funds. If savings exceed investment, we can say that this country is a net lender. However, if it's the other way around, this country is purchasing more assets abroad, so the country will be a net borrower. Now we can discuss the market for loanable funds, where savers lend and investors borrow. The quantity of loanable funds will depend on the real interest rate. Look at the graph. The supply for loanable funds is positively related to R star, and the demand for loanable funds is negatively related to R star. The equilibrium interest rate demonstrates that the desired levels of domestic investment and net capital outflow are exactly equal to the amount that people want to save. This graph is more intuitive. Let's try with a curve shift associated to demand for loanable funds. Imagine that the demand for loanable funds increases because of higher and more accessible credit supply. This causes the demand curve to shift upwards as the orange curve. As a result, we can observe how the real interest rate increases. If R star increases, savings will be encouraged, less incentive for residents to access those foreign credits. The equilibrium interest rate demonstrates that the desired levels of domestic investment and net capital outflow are exactly equal to the amount that people want to save. Putting everything together, we arrive at the equilibrium in the open economy. What does this show us? On the left, we have the market for loanable funds, and down on the right, we have the market for foreign currency exchange. Then we have a third graph, which represents the NCO, the link between both markets. This curve is sloped downwards because, as we've just seen, NCO is negatively related to the real interest rate. How does this link operate? The supply and demand for loanable funds in the first panel determine the real interest rate. This will establish the quantity of NCO. The quantity of NCO is the supply of dollars in the foreign currency exchange market, as we can see in the graph indicated by the arrow. This supply curve, in conjunction with the demand for dollars determined by NX in the foreign currency exchange market, determines the real exchange rate in panel. In other words, the real interest rate and the real exchange rate must find their equilibrium to balance supply and the demand in the two markets. As they do so, they determine the levels of national saving, domestic investment, net capital outflow, and net exports. What are the most common mistakes? First of all, remember to establish the difference between local and foreign variables. It is important to be clear about which country or economy you are standing from. That is what's going to establish the difference between exports and imports. For example, if country A sells goods to a country B, and we are analyzing country A is exporting to country B. If we stand from country B, then country B is importing from country A. Also, remember how exchange rate and interest rate are related to this variable. For example, if real interest rate increases, it will encourage local savings, since the added amount to the original investments will be higher. But these savings will be encouraged to purchase local assets, and foreign investors will be encouraged to buy more assets from this country as well. The local savings will be encouraged to purchase foreign goods if the local interest rate decreases or the international interest rate increases. That is all. This video was an introduction of the basics of an open economy. An open economy involves the international flow of assets and goods. This involves the equilibrium of two markets, loanable funds and foreign currency exchange. An open economy reaches an equilibrium according to the adjustments of the real interest rate and the real exchange rate. This will establish levels for national savings, domestic investment, net capital outflow, and net exports. So with this video, you have gained deeper knowledge about how open economies work. I hope you have enjoyed it. And also, if you want to learn more about the topic, feel free to explore on Chegg.